Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour, who came and suffered and died for sinners and made an atonement for his people, all who become by the enabling of the Holy Spirit also, bless us now, look upon us, so stir our hearts that we may come before thee with thanksgiving and worship, and O Lord, hold needy souls to thyself. Even this night, come and work in our hearts, open thy word to our understanding, come in great power and blessing, show thy saving love, O Lord, look upon us all, and refresh us and draw us to thyself this night, as we wait upon thee. We ask these things in the name of our Saviour, for his sake. Amen. Let's sing together the hymn, number 72, version 1. Hymn number 72, version 1. Based on the 72nd Psalm, Jesus shall reign wherever the sun does his successive journeys on.
Thank you.
years is a tale that is told. The days of our years are 80 years and 10. And if by reason of strength they be 80 years, yet is their strength labour and sorrow, for it is soon cut off, and we fly away. Who knoweth the power of thine anger? Even according to thy fear, so is thy wrath. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. Return, O Lord, how long, and let it repent thee concerning thy servants. O satisfy us early with thy mercy, that we may rejoice and be glad all our days. Make us glad according to the days wherein thou hast afflicted us, and the years wherein we have seen evil. Let thy work appear unto thy servants, and thy glory unto their children. And live Gospel of Mark, chapter 5. The Gospel of Mark, chapter 5. We begin to read from verse 21. And when Jesus was passed over again by ship unto the other side, much people gathered unto him, and he was nigh unto the sea. Behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet and besought him greatly, saying, My little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her, that she may be healed, and she shall live. And Jesus went with him, and much people followed him and thronged him. And a certain woman, which had an issue of blood 12 years, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all that she had, was nothing better, but rather grew worse. When she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind him, and touched his garments. For she said, If I may but touch his clothes, I shall be whole. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, Who touched my clothes? And his disciples said unto him, Thou seest the multitude thronging thee, and sayest thou, Who toucheth me? And he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. And the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him, and told him all the truth. And he said unto her, Daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace, and behold thy plague. While he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain which said, Thy daughter is dead. Why troublest thou the master any further? As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he said unto the ruler of the synagogue, Be not afraid, only believe. And he suffered no man to follow him, save Peter and James and John, the brother of James. And he cometh to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and seeth the tumult, and them that wept and wailed greatly. And when he was come in, he saith unto them, Why make ye this ado, and weep? The damsel is not dead, but sleepeth. And they laughed him to scorn. But when he had put them all out, he taketh the father and the mother of the damsel, and them that were with him, and entered in where the damsel was lying. And he took the damsel by the hand, and saith unto her, Talitha cumi, which is being interpreted, Damsel, I say unto thee, Arise. And straightway the damsel arose and walked, for she was of the age of 12 years. And they were astonished with a great astonishment, and he charged them straightly that no man should know it, and commanded that something should be given her to eat. God add his blessing to that further reading of his word, grant us all understanding. We give a warm welcome to those who are visitors with us and also to those who join us on live webcasts. We pray that you will know the Lord's blessing as we hear the gospel of his grace this evening. The preacher is our pastor, Dr. Peter Masters. Audio and video recordings of recent ministry are available in the entrance vestibule. Today's ministry will be available after this evening service, and our magazine Thought and Trial can also be obtained. Now this year, New Year's Eve being today, the Lord's Day, there'll be
service begins at 7:30 and is followed by a time of fellowship and refreshments, and we encourage all to join with us on Wednesday evening to study God's Word. Our service next Sunday will be at 11 in the morning and 6:30 in the evening, when the preacher, God willing, will be our pastor. At the close of this evening service, Dr. Masters and Pastor Ibrahim will be available in their vestries for any who would like to speak. And now the steward will take up our offering for the Lord's work.
Many times we've seen conviction grip hearts and and that great longing to be clean and to be changed and to know thee and walk with thee. O Lord, it is not according to human nature. We would run a mile, we would seek to pursue the kind of lives we dreamed of and have all that we wanted and do all the things we wish to do. O Lord, we would not want anything spiritual or divine. We would not want to come under thy authority. We praise and thank you, Lord, for that mighty work which draws us near and causes us to desire thee and feel our need of thee and then bow the knee to thee. O Lord, this very night we pray that thou wilt make plain Calvary and the work of Christ and all that he has done. Deal with us all, we pray. Let none go out of this place unhelped, unilluminated, untroubled. O Lord, come in thy strange work and save souls and deal with us according to thy great mercy and thy love. O Lord, come, we pray, and help us now and work in hearts by the mighty power of the Holy Spirit. We ask these things in the name of our Saviour, for his sake. Amen.
Amen.
Listen together to hymn 254. Hymn number 254. My song is Love Unknown.
Thank you.
members this evening to consider the narrative, the account of the healing, that just these words, which appear also in the Gospel of Luke, in a parallel account, only believe. Because just as only belief in Christ was needed for the child of the ruler of the synagogue to be healed, only belief is required for salvation. That's our subject. Why believing is essential. I'd like to consider just this topic this evening. To come to God, to approach Him, to encounter Him, to enter into connection, relationship with Him. How is it to be done? How? And the answer of the Lord is, only believe. And we need to examine this. It's so tremendously important. First of all, we need to deal with some negatives and clear away some errors, some mistakes, foolish and terrible mistakes, soul-destroying mistakes. You can never know God. You can never know reconciliation with Him if you don't understand what it means, only believe, and the significance of those words. There are many people, numerous people, who think that to secure any contact with God, any communion with Him, is, well, it's a matter of presumption. You may take it for granted. You may take it for granted that God, if He is there, is ready and willing to receive us, whatever the spirit of our approach, whenever we make it, with no terms, no conditions, that we can just take Him for granted and call upon Him anyhow we like. Doesn't need to affect our lives. Doesn't need to change us. Doesn't require any devotion, any dedication, any commitment to Him. We can just do it. That is probably the most widespread belief in how to approach God. As though God is unoffendable, God is unconcerned about us, He is not in any sense a holy God, there is no kind of barrier between us and God, there is no such thing as sin and no significance in that, no problem of guilt, nothing to prevent us just taking it for granted that we can approach God on any terms, at any time, just as we please, pick Him up, put Him down, do whatever we like. That's the most widespread belief. And it's extraordinarily mistaken. And obviously mistaken. It assumes, as I say, that God is unoffendable, has no standards, no concerns, isn't anything could possibly separate us from Him or prevent us just from calling upon Him whenever we want for anything and then dropping Him accordingly. We can switch from atheism to belief overnight and back again and back again. That's presumption. And it's ignorant and it's foolish. And the whole of the Word of God, the whole of the Bible, really begins with that. You can't do that. You can't do that with God. That's out of the question. That's ignorance of God and His being and His majesty and His holiness. That ignorance is the great barrier that separates us from God. So I start with that, because it is so widespread. And I hope nobody here thinks that God can just be approached anyhow. And then there's another, I can run through one or two very quickly, things that are wrong. There is the notion, which is very widespread in the world, that God is easily approached by works, by us just mending our ways and straightening out a bit and doing some good in this world, giving something back, just doing something receive us. He's not the injured party. He's not the God who is wrong. He's not the Holy One. Some works, and we are conceited enough, if you don't mind my using the term, to think that we can accomplish those works. We can do sufficient to earn the merit from God, favour from Him, to be accepted by Him, for Him to be pleased with us. We think, when it suits us, we can accomplish that. Friends, that's another false approach which the Bible deals with. Throughout, God cannot be approached by some works. And then there's yet another false approach, which has been very common in world history and in holy religions, and that is that God may be approached by ceremonies. You'd be amazed how widespread this has been. And maybe you've been involved with a faith which believes in ceremonies. As long as you go through certain ceremonies, maybe you have, unwittingly, maybe you're baptized as a baby. In the mistaken belief that through being baptized, sprinkled with water as a baby, somehow that imparted grace to you and acceptance with God. So you're all right. You've nothing to be concerned about. It's a ceremony. Fortune, reconciliation with God. And people believe that through life. Smells and bells, smoke and jingles, and ceremonies, and costumes and so on, can bring about reconciliation with God, as though God is a great fan of pantomime. Enactments of that kind. And that ought to occur to all of us as being preposterous. And it is. And it's another approach which is not valid, can never bring a soul into union, into contact with Almighty God. And there are many people who think that all that it needs to be reconciled with God, to approach Him, is a simple mental assent that He is there. I believe in God. I believe in Christ. Said vaguely, often. As though that gets me home and dry. I've assented to God. It hasn't changed my life. I haven't repented of my sin. I haven't really sought Him. I feel no touch from God affecting me in any way. I don't hunger and thirst for Him or live for Him. But I've assented. Isn't that enough? No, it isn't, friends. Don't be mistaken. Assent. Mental assent is enough. I could talk about meditational techniques. Or adopt some of the widely publicized meditational techniques to get in touch with the God who is in you. Or the God who you are. And various other things. Or to get in touch with the spiritual essence of God. It's all mysticism. Technique can bring you into contact with God. But that's really a conceit of the imagination. No such thing. You can't contact God by the technique to contact the Almighty Spirit. Some people try visualization of various things. I won't go into it. There are mistaken ways to approach God, which get you nowhere. And your soul is not safe. And you stand before God one day, eternally condemned. Belief and believing in the New Testament has a very special meaning. To begin with, when the Scripture teaches that we must believe, it means it as opposed to works. Belief is required rather than works, rather than presumption, rather than ceremony. Those things are no good. Belief. But the next question is, what kind of belief? And that's what we're going to talk about just briefly now. Belief. Here's the great thing about believing. Believing involves the understanding. In preaching, to your mind, to your understanding. I'm not appealing directly to your emotions, but to the mind. Believing is an act of the mind. To believe, you must understand what you're believing in. You must know something about it. So the Christian message, the Christian faith, the message of salvation, first of all, must appeal to the mind and must persuade about certain vital facts. Facts about God, facts about ourselves, facts about how God has made it possible for us to be reconciled with Him. You've got to believe in those things. When Christ says, only believe, it's facts you've got to believe about Him, about God in general. It involves the understanding. That's the first great point. Believing is about the understanding. We've been studying in weeknight Bible lectures, the book of Leviticus. You've seen right back in ancient times, the times of Moses, how the people were taught, the mind was instructed. They were given a very graphical kind of education. They were given, in olden times, a sacrificial system. Why the Israelites, they'd been in bondage in Egypt as slaves for generations. And now their minds were to be educated how God saves, how God reconciles. So they were given visual aids along with the instruction. The sacrifices were visual aids. They couldn't themselves bring about forgiveness, but they taught the people how God forgives. What happens is this, the sacrifices said. There must be an atonement. There must be a representative. Someone must take the punishment for your sin. That's how God will do it. That's how He must do it. One day He will send a Savior. And that Savior will somehow take the punishment and take away the guilt of your sin. And this is a picture. You will slay a bullock. Before you do so, you will lay your hand upon the head of the bullock. This is all way in the past. But you see how the mind is taught. And by doing that, you transfer your sin to the bullock. And the bullock is then sacrificed because there must be a sacrifice, a price paid. Someone must die for your sin. Someone must be punished for your sin. And then in the smoke that ascends from the burning of the sacrifice, it is like a sweet savour, because that sacrificial victim must offer up righteousness, which you don't have, to deserve the blessings of God for you. So the sacrifice, you see, was a lesson. It instructed the mind. People who have been generations in slavery were being taught deep things. There must be an atonement for sin. Another will suffer for you. It will, of course, be the Son of God, who in due time would come and take in His own body the punishment for the sins of all who would be saved. The mind was instructed. You think of those ancient times. They had a tabernacle, later a temple, and it had a holy of holies. And God was remote and unapproachable, so it would seem. Oh, but He could be approached. But He was behind His presence. The representatives of His presence were behind a curtain. And the priests that were appointed had to go through all kinds of washings, even to get near that place. The mind was being instructed. God is holy. He cannot be approached by you as you are. There has to be a mediator, a go-between. Your sins have to be forgiven for you to be accepted before God. His holiness would destroy you if you had any means of access to Him, unforgiven. And this is what believing is about. The mind has to be instructed. You have to understand the holiness and majesty of God, the fallen, sinful state of our hearts, the need for a mediator and reconciliation. You don't just believe, that's it. I'm home and dry. No. difficult to understand. So now we don't have that system of worship. That stopped with the coming of Christ. The graphics, the pictures, the illustrations. But it's the same thing. We talk now didactically, but the mind has to take in. And that's what we're briefly dealing with this evening. You have to grasp the holiness of God and his approach, unapproachability, unless we're cleansed and forgiven by him. You have to grasp the lost condition of men and women. We're lost. We're cut off from him. We've broken his commandments. And we are in a state of sin. Our hearts are fallen and sinful. It's not just the things we do and say. We are by nature, until God converts us and changes and begins to work in us, we are by nature proud. We are. Of course, there's good in everyone. And there's some love in everyone. God keeps it there by his grace. But nevertheless, human nature is still a mess and corrupted and ruined. And there were lies in everyone, and pride in everyone, and greed in everyone, and uncleanness in people too. All kinds of things. Our heart is in a bad, fallen state and condition. That's why we need a mediator. We need a sin bearer, someone to take the punishment of our sin, so that God can embrace us and receive us. And we need to see the lost condition of this world. The world goes on. There are wonderful things in the world because God has given the human race the brilliant minds and creativity. There are always advances and discoveries and many amazing things. But there are many other things that are always the same. Fights, quarrels, meanness, jealousy, violence, wars, troubles, unspeakable cruelty and unkindness going on all around us all the time. And we'll never get any better because we are a corrupt race. So we have to accept that. I am a sinner before God. To be reconciled with him, I need his forgiveness. I need a saviour. I need someone to take the burden of my sin away, and I need to be changed. So you have to grasp lost condition. Only believe. I don't wish to make it complicated, but believe what? That I need reconciliation with God. God is holy, I am corrupt. These are the things we must understand and believe. Then we have to grasp the person and work of Jesus Christ. Only believe in him. He is that Saviour. God has come himself, the second person of the Godhead, we read in the scripture. He has come. He fulfills all the ancient pictures of atonement and so on. Of course, even before he came, the prophets saw it. That most famous passage in Isaiah chapter 53, and I'll just read from verse 4. He's predicting Christ's glory. He hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. The personal work of Christ. Christ came into this world, took upon himself a human body, born as a babe in Bethlehem. Who doesn't know that? In order that he could be our mediator, our sin bearer, our scapegoat, went to Calvary's cross, allowed himself in what seemed to be weakness, but he was never weak. He could have avoided himself to be taken and cruelly mistreated and flogged and nailed to a cross, and God the Father laid upon him all the guilt of everyone in the world who would ever be forgiven, and punished him instead of us in a punishment which was largely invisible. It was so intense and so terrible, deep in his soul, he suffered all the separation from God and all the anguish and horror and pain that we should have borne forever, just concentrated into a space of time to 6 hours, and bore it away. And in doing that, he purchased salvation for us. You must understand that. That's what you must believe. I believe God is holy. I believe I am separated from him because I am depraved and corrupt and a sinner. But I believe God has sent a Saviour, Jesus Christ the Lord, equal with the Father, and he has suffered so terribly in his great love to save a wretched world like me. I believe in him with all my heart, you say. He is the only way of salvation. Nobody else could have done that. No angel could possibly have done it. No human being could have done it. He would have had his own sin. And the first few seconds of the agonies of Calvary's cross would have destroyed him. Only Christ could be my Saviour. Because he came as a man, he could truly suffer for me in my place. Because he was God, he could be sustained through the most terrible hours imaginable. We believe in him and his great love, his person. He was only his work on Calvary's cross for sinners. Then we must believe in eternity. This is the issue. I'm not just here for life. I'm created by God with an immortal soul. When I die, at the end of this life, I go into eternity. I stand before God in judgment. Am I going to be everlastingly banished? Or am I going to be received by him? Eternity is at stake, friends. Eternity is what counts, as well as life. In fact, what counts most, must believe in that. This is a matter of heaven or hell. And then you must believe in the exclusive soul-saving efficacy of the death of Christ. The exclusive effectiveness or efficacy of the death of Christ. Don't try to put anything alongside it. Some people have done that. Yes, I hear what you say, I believe in Christ. So if I can offer some imagined righteousness of my own, plus some belief in Christ, that's bound to get me to heaven. No, no, it won't. You have to say to yourself, I believe I am altogether lost. I am beyond repair. I cannot, by any strength of my own, possibly honour God's perfect standards. I need Christ 100%, and nothing else. I must give myself to him, hand over my life to him, love him, seek him, find him, allow him to change me and work within me to truly transform me. That's what we call conversion. Just believe in that. And just finally, dear friends, I must tell you this. You must believe in what we call, but the terminology is not important, the warrant of faith. The authority for faith. I'll explain to you what that means. You must understand that in believing, if you truly believe in the holiness of God, your own corruption and separation from him, person and work of Christ as an atoning Saviour, then heaven and hell is an issue, eternity is at stake. If you truly believe these things, then you will be saved. There is a warrant for your faith. In this very verse, for example, Jesus says unto the ruler of the synagogue, "Be not afraid, only believe." Do you hear the authority for faith to the ruler of the synagogue? Don't be afraid, only believe. In that statement, there is the sense, if you believe, you have nothing to fear. If you believe, your daughter will certainly be healed. If you believe that I am Messiah, Christ meant, that I am the Lord, I will heal your daughter. The phrase is pregnant with assurance, with authority. It is a warrant for the man's faith. Can't you hear it? Be not afraid, only believe. That is an absolute assurance. And there are others such in the Bible. You need to understand these. I turn quickly to John's Gospel in chapter 3, for example. And here is John, Christ, speaking to a proud Pharisee. I'll read a few verses to you. Jesus answered, this is an answer to a man named Nicodemus. Jesus answered, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God." He needs to be converted. He needs to be changed. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. To be reconciled with God, you need a spiritual life, a new life. "Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again." But now I read from verse 14, where Christ continues to say, "As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up," he's hinting at his death on Calvary's cross, "that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting and have eternal life." Now that's an absolute assurance. If you read it in the Greek, it's even more obvious. "Whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." It's an authority. It's an assurance. It's a warrant of faith. If you believe in the manner I've been describing, with all your heart, you believe enough to repent of your sin, you believe enough to turn your life over to Christ, you'll have eternal life. It's important. How are you going to pray to God? You're going to pray to God on the basis of these promises. I just, for one further reference, I turn you over to John's Gospel, chapter 6, and I read verse 35. Listen to these glorious words. "And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst." It's an expression of absolute assurance. It's a warrant for faith. It's an authority. So when you bow your head in prayer, you go home, find a quiet place, say, I believe in the holiness of God. I believe in my own corruption and sinful state. I believe Christ is a Saviour who suffered and died for sinners. I believe it absolutely with all my heart. I believe eternity is at stake. Then what are you going to do? Lord, save me. Lord, help me. Will your heart and your mind be full of doubts even as you pray? Will you be saved yourself? Yes, but will you save me? Will he hear me? How can I be sure? You need a warrant, an authority for your faith. And that's what I'm trying to point out to you in these wonderful verses. Verse 35, "He that believeth on me shall never thirst." And verse 37 of John. John chapter 6, all that the Father giveth me shall come to me. And listen to this, and him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. That's an assurance, an authority, a warrant. So when you pray, and when you repent, as long as you do it sincerely, with all your heart, and you believe these things we've been speaking about this evening, you know that Christ will hear you, and he will stretch forth his hand and save you and forgive you and make you his own and work that great work of conversion in your heart so that you're a different person and a new person. He will keep his promise. This is an authority for you. He has promised. There's an old couplet in a now defunct hymn verse, which I like. It runs like this. His honour and his name's at stake to save me from the burning lake. He's made a promise. He will keep it. His honour and his name is at stake. He never broke a promise. It's as if you believe. And I've told you what to believe. If you believe these doctrines, these truths, and especially the person and work of Christ, that you give him your life and repent of your sin, you're bound to be saved if you do it with all your heart. Because he's promised, and he has perfect integrity. And not only does he have perfect integrity, he has all the power to keep his promise. He can transform anyone. So, dear friends, believe. Believing is about the understanding. It's believing, not by works, not by deserving. Believing is a very humble thing. Only believe. That word only has almost a dual sense. Only believe. It's not meritorious. It's not works. It doesn't deserve anything. It's not complex. I hope I haven't made it complex. Only believe. And with all your heart, and Christ will save you. See the lost condition. See the person and work of Christ, the only mediator between God and man. See that this is a matter of your eternal destiny. See the exclusive soul-saving power and effectiveness of Christ. Don't put anything alongside him. And hold in your hand the warrant of faith. I have these promises of God. Lord, forgive me. Lord, change me. Lord, bring me to thyself. And if you're sincere, he will, without doubt. You may be sure. So I come back to conclude to this Gospel of Mark, chapter 5, and the 36th verse. Only believe. That's what it means. Only believe. Let's pray together. Don't allow our pride and foolishness to carry us away. Or don't allow us to be so enamored by the superficial and passing things of this world that we dismiss these things. Look upon us and help us from this very night. Or Lord, work in thy great kindness and save souls. Draw to thyself. We ask these things in our dear Saviour's name.